Hello everyone, I am Prashant Kumar, Assistant Professor of English at Government College for Women, Karnal. I welcome you to this lecture on the story Pigeons at Daybreak, written by Anita Desai. This story has been prescribed for BA second semester students of the universities of Haryana. This lecture has been prepared under the aegis of the Department of Higher Education, Haryana. My dear students, because this is the first chapter of the syllabus, many of you must be wondering how to approach a story, how to read a story, and which elements to look at while reading a story. Now I will try to acquaint you with a few of the most important elements that you must keep in mind while reading a story. I have given you 6 elements that you must look at while studying a story. These 6 elements are the title of the story, the theme of the story, point of view, setting, characters and characterization, beginning and end of the story. I'll take up these elements one by one with reference to the story that we are studying, so that you can understand all the elements, and at the same time this will help you understand the present story. Title is one of the key elements while reading a story, because it will tell you many things about the story, about its theme and what to expect. The writer can use many strategies to give a title to his story. The story might be named after a character. For example, The Child in a Syllabus by Premchand. The title may be a date, name of a city, place, etc. Or it might even be the name of a thing. For example, Punchlight by Phaneeshwarnath Renu. The story may be named after an event or incident. For example, The Journey, the third story. Here the title is both literal, because it is an actual journey, and it's also a symbolic title. And lastly, the title may be symbolic. It might not have a direct reference to an incident in the story or a character in the story, but such a title is related to the theme of the story. For example, our present story is titled Pigeons at Daybreak. The story is neither about pigeons nor about daybreak. In his book Aspects of the Novel, E.M. Foster has discussed 2 types of characters: flat characters and round characters. Flat characters are relatively uncomplicated and do not change during the course of the story. You will find such characters in traditional stories. And second are the type of characters are the round characters, which are complex and they undergo development. They have the potential to surprise you. Flat characters will not surprise you. Most of the modern stories, they will provide you with complex or round characters. Here in this story, we can say that both the characters are round characters. It's very important to look at the beginning and the end of a story. Beginning is important because it marks the entry of the reader into the story. The beginning should be attractive, so that it can arouse the interest of the reader. Similarly, the ending, it should be logical and convincing. The ending of most of the traditional stories is of the closed type. It means all the complications of the story find a resolution at the end. But the modern stories, they remain open-ended. I mean, you will not get a sense of closure at the end. Sometimes the writer uses the method called sting in the tail, that suddenly exactly the opposite of what you expect to happen happens in the end. Anita Desai is an eminent and famous Indian English writer. She was born to a German mother and a Bengali father. Desai grew up speaking German, Hindi, and English. She received a BA in English from the University of Delhi in 1957. The suppression and oppression of Indian women were the subjects of her first novel, Cry the Peacock, which was published in 1963, and a later novel, Where Shall We Go This Summer? Fire on the Mountain, which was published in 1977, was criticized as relying too heavily on imagery at the expense of plot and characterization. But it was praised for its poetic symbolism and use of sounds. Clear Light of the Day, published in 1980, considered the author's most successful work, is praised for its highly evocative portrait of two sisters caught in the lassitude of Indian life. Its characters are revealed not only through imagery but through gesture, dialogue, and reflection. As do most of her works, the novel reflects Desai's essentially tragic view of life. Other novels by Desai include In Custody and Journey to Ithaca. Fasting Feasting, which was published in 1999, takes as its subject the connections and gaps between Indian and American culture, while The Zigzag Way, published in 2004, tells the story of an American academic who travels to Mexico to trace his Cornish ancestry. Desai also wrote short fiction, short stories, etc. Collections include Games at Twilight and Other Stories, and Diamond Dust and Other Stories, and several children's books, including The Village by the Sea. The Artist of Disappearance, published in 2011, collected three novellas that examined the collateral abandonment and dislocation wrought by India's furious rush toward modernity. Her daughter Kiran Desai won the Booker Prize for the novel The Inheritance of Loss in 2006. She herself has received the prestigious Sahitya Akademi Award. Her novels have been nominated thrice for the Booker Prize. We'll now discuss the story in detail, keeping in mind the elements mentioned earlier. The action of the story mainly consists of the happenings, or we can say lack thereof, from one afternoon to the morning of the next day. The story presents a slice of life, so to speak, from the life of Otima and her husband Basu. They reside in a congested lane of Daryaganj area of Old Delhi. There are no grand events lined up for the reader. It is routine existence. At the beginning, we find the husband waiting for the newspaper to be read for him. For this, he depends on his wife, and it hurts his male pride. Let me quote. One of his worst afflictions, Mr. Basu thought, was not to be able to read the newspaper himself. To have them read to him by his wife, he watched with fiercely controlled irritation that made the corner of his mouth jerk suddenly upwards and outwards as she searched for her spectacles through the flat. The beginning tells us all the necessary details: Basu's illness, his nature, the equation between the husband and wife. But Otima has become used to such irritable temper of her husband and ignores his whims. As you can see, but Otima Basu never heard such sounds, such ironies or distress. Quite pleased with all she had accomplished and at having a half an hour in which to sit down comfortably. The next part of the story consists mainly of Otima's reading of the newspaper for her husband. And because of his illness, none of the news items seems to arouse his interest. As you can see, what else, Mr. Basu snapped. We also get some information about Otima, that she is a graduate and that they have two children. We also come to know that Otima is sensitive about gender issues. You can see the element of protest in her. As he says, I'm reading right, she protested. Think I can't read? Did my BA, helped two children through school and college, and you think I cannot read? Blue bulls, it says here. Blue bulls it is. These things lead us to the crisis of the story. When Otima reads the news about the lights being switched off during the night. Let me read it. Yes. Electricity will be switched off as urgent repairs to power lines must be made in Daryaganj and Kashmiri Gate area from 8 p.m. to 6 a.m. on the 21st of May. My God, that's today. Today, tonight, no electricity, he echoed, letting the green chili fall to the floor of the cage where other offered and refused chilies lay in rotting heap. Now here the image of the parrot, you can contrast it with the image of the pigeons. The parrot is caged while pigeons are free. So the husband and wife, mainly the husband, can be compared with the parrot. How will I sleep then? He gasped fearfully, without a fan in this heat. And already his diaphragm seemed to cave in, his chest to rise and fall as he panted for breath. Clutching his throat, he groped his way back to the cane chair. Otima, Otima, I cannot breathe. This triggers the attack of asthma. And the image of the parrot, which you can also see elsewhere in the story, it reinforces the sense of being choked. But you can see that Otima is cool and calm even under these trying circumstances. She goes on about her work as usual. She plans to take him to the terrace for the night, for which Bulu, the neighbor, helps them. Here we have the first flashback of the story when they used to sleep on the terrace during summers and why they stopped it. It's here. They had given up sleeping there on the summer nights long ago, not so much on account of old age or weak knees really, but because of their perpetual quarrels with the neighbors on the next terrace, separated from theirs by only a broken wooden trellis. Noisy, inconsiderate people, addicted to the radio, turned on full blast. At times, the man had been drunk and troubled and abused his wife, who gave as good as she got. It had been intolerable. Here you can also see, here, Otima had urged her husband night after night to protest. When he did, they had almost killed him. So, the husband, he's timid, he lacks courage. And because of the quarrel, they had stopped sleeping on the stairs. Now here, they also, we get the flashback about their grandson. When they take him to the terrace, he sat there getting back his breath and thinking of Nikhil. Nikhil is their grandson. When would he see Nikhil again? What would he not give to him to have that child hold his thumb again and go for a walk with him? So the child is a symbol of happiness. He's nostalgic about the child, and it shows the difference between their present agony and their past happiness. The night it remains restless for Otima and her husband. He could not find any solace on the terrace, and the resolution in the story comes suddenly towards dawn when Otima notices that there was light in the flat. To her surprise, there was a light on their flat, and this light brings hope that her husband could get at least some sleep towards the morning. It brings relief. The relief of it brought her energy back in a bound. She bustled up the stairs. I'll bring him down. He will get some hours of sleep after all, she told herself. So the story, which begins at a very sad note ends with a ray of hope. Morning, there is morning, there is breeze, sweet, a pure pallor, unlike the livid glow of the artificial lights. So nature against culture, and this image of the pigeons at the end. Then with the swirl and flutter of feathers, a flock of pigeons hurled upwards and spread out against the dome of the sky, opalescent, sunlit, like small pearls. They caught the light as they rose, turned brighter, till they turned at last into crystals, into prisms of light. So light is a symbol of hope. Then they disappeared into the soft, deep blue of the morning. So we can say the story ends on an optimistic note, because pigeons, they themselves signify freedom and hope. First of all, we will discuss the title of the story. The title of any story tells us a lot about that story. I mean, what type of title is it? The title tells us what to expect from the story. In this case, the title of the story is symbolic. The title is Pigeons at Daybreak. Now, the questions that might arise in our mind are, is the story about pigeons? Not really. We are aware the story is about an old couple. Then we have to assume that the title must be symbolic. Pigeons are a symbol of peace, and being birds, they are also a symbol of freedom. Being birds, they are also a symbol of movement. But what kind of movement? This is the movement from darkness to light, from disease to health, from pessimism to hope, and from night to day. That's why daybreak has been mentioned in the title. The title would also tell us that this old couple is seeking freedom from their mundane routine. They are seeking freedom from the disease, from loneliness. The title tells us in advance what to expect from the story. We cannot expect much action in this story. Rather, we will have to understand the inner landscape of the characters with the help of symbols. Although this is a very short story, it throws up so many themes and sub-themes for us to ponder. One of the most important themes that the story contains is the life in a city. These are the same themes that Eliot was trying to bring up in his poems. The theme of alienation, loneliness, boredom, insecurity. The theme of loneliness has been brought up in a significant way because there is no one to look after the old couple, and it is quite clear that they are feeling lonely. Their life is full of boredom. That's why the husband, he keeps asking his wife to read newspaper for him. At the same time, he seems least interested in any news because he keeps asking her to read something else, to read something interesting. His wife reads one news after the other for him, but it doesn't seem to interest him. Let me quote from the text. He says, "What else? What else?" Mr. Basu snapped at her, "Nothing else in the papers." This shows the kind of boredom that he is facing, but at the same time, there is no other way out except to listen to the same stale news again and again. The story also brings to the forefront the marital relationship, the relationship of love-hate between a husband and wife. The wife seems irritated with her husband. Obviously, he is ill, she has to look after him. At the same time, he cannot leave his male arrogance. He knows that he has to depend on his wife to read the newspaper for him. In fact, for everything he has to depend on his wife. But even then he is not able to bring himself to believe that he has to depend on her. Anita Desai has made a very clever use of the city landscape to bring out the themes of this story. The loneliness of the couple is quite in contrast with the hustle and bustle of a busy city of Delhi. The author has made a very clever use of this background at various stages of the story to make her themes quite clear. The writer has also underlined the lack of space in the city, lack of even breathing space. The balconies are quite close to each other and they are far removed from nature and natural surroundings, although the writer talks of, at the end, she talks of some breeze coming from, and she qualifies it with the sluggish river Jamuna beneath the city walls. So initially there is stifling congestion of the city, but towards the end there is some hope. This background of the city stands for the mental state of the characters. It shows their frustrations. The writer is also able to show us the polluted environment of the city and how it affects the life of the individuals. She has made clever use of the imagery of the city and lights to bring out her themes. For example, this paragraph on page number 6, and I quote: punctually at 8 o'clock the electricity was switched off, immediately sucking up Daryaganj into a box of shadows so that the distant glow of Connaught Place still lit up was emphasized. The horizon was illuminated as by a fire, roasted red. The traffic made long stripes of light up and down the streets below them. Lying back, Basu saw the dome of the sky as absolutely impenetrable, shrouded by summer dust, and it seemed to him as airless as the room below. Nikhil, Nikhil, he wept, as though the child might have helped. Now you can easily see the use of colors, the use of contrast. While Daryaganj is in shadows, Connaught Place is bright. So while we can say that while the couple is under the shadow of sadness, people at other places might be quite happy. And talking of the dome of the sky being impenetrable shows hopelessness, that Basu thinks that like the sky cannot be penetrated, in a similar way his sorrow cannot be penetrated by any happiness, and this is the right time to remember his son. So it's very important to understand these images of dust, pollution, smoke, so that we can understand the mental state of the characters. As there is a choked environment around them, it also showed the choked nature of their consciousness. As you can see, there are only two main characters in the story, Otima and her husband Basu. The focus remains on the two of them throughout, as the story portrays their relationship and a day in their life. We will first see Otima, what kind of person she is. As you can easily see, Otima plays her gender role to perfection. Although there are shades of revolt in her character, but mainly she remains within the traditional role of a devoted wife. That is the gender role prescribed for her. She has her share of internal resentments, And there is an element of protest as well, as you can see on the very first page itself in the last paragraph, and I quote, "But Otima Basu never heard such sounds, such ironies and distresses. Quite pleased with all she had accomplished and at having half an hour in which to sit down comfortably." This shows that although her husband is visibly angry with her because she is delaying reading the newspaper for him, but she hardly cares. This is a kind of soft protest from her side that she wants to save time for herself, and she is quite comfortable with and happy with whatever she has achieved in life. She doesn't have much of an internal strife or internal tension, which obviously Basu goes through. It doesn't mean that she is not devoted towards her husband and she ignores him. She is quite hardworking. She not only takes care of her ailing husband, but she also does all the household work alone. She has her own choices, while her, in terms of the kind of news she likes, overall she has a very positive outlook towards life. She wants to read the entertainment or movie section of the newspaper, and she is also quite aware of the kind of atrocities on women in our society, which she really expresses when she reads that news on page number 3, top section, of a mother-in-law and husband pouring kerosene on some girl and setting her on fire. So she is aware of such things also. But overall, we can say that she is satisfied with her role, and she is the person who never gives up. She is a true fighter, in fact. She wants to fight against all odds. You can also gaze her personality from the fact which is mentioned in another pair on page number 3, and I quote, "She herself at 56 had not a wrinkle on her oiled face, scarcely a grey hair on her head, as smooth as butter, as round as a cake. Life might still have been delectable to her if it had not been for the asthma that afflicted her husband and made him seem at 61 almost decrepit." So her physical attributes also show that she is a confident woman, and her situation has not affected her as much as it could affect some other weak person. On the other hand, her husband, from the beginning to the end, is, although afflicted from asthma, is also otherwise also seems a frustrated husband. He wants to dominate but doesn't have the power to dominate, and this is one dimension of his frustration. He starts crying at the slightest provocation. So we can contrast their characters, as we can see that the wife is very strong and the husband is quite weak. These are some suggested readings if you want to read further about the writer and her works. I have given some review questions here. I'll request the students to try and attempt these questions to gauge their understanding of the story. Thanks a lot, dear students. I hope you will find this video useful in understanding this story.